and Jane Diego, our staff member. Please take a look at the adoption of agenda. Is there any agenda that you would like to add in? None. Let's move on. Let's review the minutes for September 6, 2013 regular session.
Thank you. initial reaction to this letter is that this letter is really desperate to mess to you out. I'm not going to engage in a legal argument with anybody, but I will tell you what the interpretation of that statute is. For new appointees, there is a 3-year point, there's a 3-year term. Okay? For existing holdover appointees, they continue to hold over until the governor sends them a notice that says, thank you for your service, I'm appointing somebody else. That's the way we would look at that in terms of ourselves. We're not going to take any questions.
I'm sorry, I cannot hear some stuff. Well, there's a border. I really can't hear some of the board members, what they're saying. If you could just speak up.
Alright, so my legal opinion, and I think it's shared by the Attorney General's office, is that for existing board members that we've been working on the law project, I'm not sure who else is. Dr. Miller, Dr. Vince, Loretta, okay, several projects. Most of you, except there's been one or two appointments. You're a new appointee. Under the Louis Scott, so you have a 3-year term.
I was just appointed again this year.
And Ed has a 3-year term. We can start to count on those terms. As to the pre-existing board members, until they hear from the governor, they continue to, what the law calls, hold over. Right? It's not a well-drafted statute. It could have addressed this issue very easily, and it didn't. So generally, the presumption of law is that. Exactly. There's been a prior opinion by the Attorney General's office, authored by Charlie Travin, I think, says that the governor has control over the appointments of the health professional bodies, because that's not the case in general. Under the organic, thank you. So the governor's legal counsel, Sandra Miller, and his kind of acts, that office acts as appointments. She's aware that they've got calendars, they've got spreadsheets and databases for who's getting off at what time. Yeah, so in answer to Ms. Sabatini's November 13th, my suggestion is to consult with the governor's office. This board doesn't have anything to do. This board, the legal opinion is that the existing board members hold over to the tomorrow. Then we got another letter, also that same day, this one by Benjamin Schiff, who I think everybody knows is Dr. Joel Joseph's son. And we got another letter, November 26th, related to that, again by Louis Sabatini. This one by Mr. Schiff says, it's November 13th, the Dear Board Chair, named Bob Hodge, why have you not discussed the last losses on your part in court? Both Judges Lamarina and Bordaglio ruled in favor of Dr. Joseph, yet you have not put any of this on your agenda. Shouldn't the board be aware of the people's taxpayers' expense on this board's court? This is standard procedure for all boards. Under oath in court, you had stated that you did not read any of the court proceedings. Furthermore, the prosecuting attorney for the board did not discuss this at a meeting or with the board members. I request this information to be made available to the public and the dialogue between the prosecuting attorney members about the losses in court should be discussed over. A number of comments about this. First of all, what is happening in court is all public. The decisions by Judge Canto, by Judge Perez, by Judge Parcinas, by Judge Lamarena, by every judge that's ever touched any of these cases, it's all public record. There has been nothing for the board, I don't think, to discuss the decision to. These cases are still on appeal, if I understand. And I believe that everything that was pending is actually gone to the next stage of the appellate stage. The best people to talk about that would be a prosecuting attorney for these cases. I've been Abrams, there may or may not be something still involved with Dave Highsmith. If the board has questions, then certainly about anything that's going on, about the nature of appeals. Obviously, the decision has been made that the judges made legal error, and that there are appealable issues. So those issues are up on appeal, and if the board wants further information, that's public record, I'm happy to provide it. Otherwise, it's available. express exception under the open government executive session. So even if the board did want to have a private conversation with the lawyers about what exactly happens next and wants some more information about what to do, maybe there's a settlement offer or something to try and resolve the case.
That seems to be out of interpretation. In the middle of all this, administration's come out with the social TV channel with one of the specific purposes is to announce meetings.
Yeah.
It should be super easy.
You're so right. And let me just kind of like, we were talking about that a little bit too. Again, you know, the legislature isn't trying to make it hard for us. They're trying to make it easy. And one of the things they did was they had this, well, you know, there's going to, DOA's going to put a website out there and everybody can put their announcements on there and that's going to happen. And we go, wow, great, we won't have that problem anymore. And then, right in the last minute, this is why I'm not really interested in talking about pending litigation, legislation. Did you hear that old thing? There's two things you never want to see being made: legislation and sausage. It'll change right at the last minute at the end, and if you're not constantly vigilant, looking at that thing every step along the way, somebody's going to sneak in and change it. And that's what happened to that website. That's why I don't put in much energies in anything that's pending out there. I'm going to put it in at the front end, but I'm going to really try and help the senators understand the difficulties of doing these jobs. And then just hope for the best that they'll carry it through. Trying to get a handle on actual cost. costs of developing these boards. We're trying to get a handle on the, you know, how much income comes in per board, how much comes in per profession, per profession within, say, this board, and how much it costs. We need to look at the data, all right? Do you know how easy it is to assemble that data? It's not, okay? You think in this day and age, right, of laptops and iPads and that kind of stuff, it would be easy, all right? We're dealing with people whose data program is still on IBM AS400, which I have hated since the 1980s, okay? And I get here and I still see that we're still connected to it in some ways, all right? So, again, it goes back to the conversation we had earlier about the difficulty in hiring programmers and database administrators and people who can do this kind of stuff with off-the-shelf software. If we were in the private sector, give me $250,000 and you'd never see both.
What about newspapers who renege on their statement that they would put the ad in?
I'm not in agreement that the newspaper, in the instance, there's been a dispute between Ben Abrams and PBN about a particular payment for a particular announcement that happened for a meeting, I think in July or August or something like that. And I'm not sure that I agree with the dispute. I tend to agree that from PBN's point of view, they're correct, and they should be paid or should be paid on the status.
This was when the free advertising was available.
She's talking about the government section. It's up to them whether they have space, because, you know, the newspaper have control. Just because you put in, you know, you don't have control with what they put in.
They're a private entity we can't control,
yeah,
what
exactly.
They publish.
But they have, if they say they're going to put it in, they have, that's their statement, and therefore they should.
Yeah, but they can change their minds too, if that's true. I mean, you know, it's, you know, the problem is that we don't, because we don't control that access of media,
yeah.
Okay? Because we don't, so in order to try and guarantee it, we have to pay for it. It goes back to the unfunded mandate. Or we rely on the kindness of strangers.
Look, honorable men can be dishonorable.
It was PDM that made really bad sausage out of the bill and should have saved us.
I'm sure.
And they came in and nobody was watching,
yeah.
Including us, including me, you know, we didn't go to.
Busy life.
We have a busy life, that's right.
Well, at this point, is anything more of this?
No, I think that I've addressed the issues in the three letters. I mean, point for point. There is a notice of something that came out at the end of December of, I think Jan Abrams is just keeping the board informed of something. As far as I know, in that case, next hearing is set for January.
That was reported last meeting.
That's right.
I have one more question, Chairman. I'm sorry. But the notaries are refusing to sign.
Okay. This is a new issue here, but I think people are trying to go to notaries and ask them to sign things like their birth certificate, their husband diploma, their marriage certificate, or something like that.
They ask you to acknowledge that document.
Okay. Like the passport, a picture. Is this a copy of their passport? That's all we're asking notaries, saying yes, I copied it for them, and this is a genuine copy of the passport that I received. They're not doing that.
That's really not what notaries do. Okay, now notary law and what the whole notary law, I mean, there's a whole test and stuff like that, but they're basically saying that the person who appeared before me swore that whatever they're swearing to is to protect the best of their knowledge. They're not saying, you know, but to go out kind of on a limb and say, well, this person is, in order to write that correctly, it's like this person appeared before me and told me that this thing was a correct copy of their passport, the document. I think that if we're having that kind of problem, the best solution is to get the actual certified copy or something.
Yeah. You're supposed to present the original to the notary and they copy it and they say that.
No, I don't know. I don't think that's the solution. I think the thing is, if you're asking for a diploma, a copy of a diploma or a certificate that the education is, transcripts, you get a directive from the issuing institution. And they will say, yes, we certify this is a copy of our records.
That's the verification. Yeah, but I believe in our law.
Well, let me just
try it though.
I mean, if you really want to be, you know, stickler about it, then that person will present their passport to Jane, and Jane can say, yeah, I saw the real thing. I'll present it to you. Yes, I saw the real thing. But I believe in the applicants that they're not going to be, you know, deceitful, saying that, you know, they're born in America while they're born in Mexico with a U.S. passport. So, you know, I'm just thinking that, you know, we don't want to be too pinpoint as far as notarizing the passport page. But I think it's important to notarize according to law the application. Yeah. So if that looks fine to you, then I don't think we should, you know, belabor the point of they have to be notarized, you know, your diploma and all that.
I agree with me. If you have a copy of the passport, whatever things that require identification, the signature on there that's notarized, say, everything that I submitted is true and correct, ought to satisfy that.
I think we got that from our law, otherwise we wouldn't have asked.
Yes, but not every single document, like a diploma and all that stuff, you know, or your passport.
Okay.
What I'm saying is that, you know, the institution of the university is supposed to send the transcript directly to the board.
Okay.
He should not be receiving a copy.
Here it is. Original law documents and credentials required by the board or notarized photocopies of other verifications of the board system. So we need to look over our checklist.
Why don't we put that on put that on the list of things to do for the next committee?
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. At this point, let's acknowledge the arrival of Dr. Chong a while ago, because I did not indicate his name for the record. Dr. Chong is with us. Let's move on to Dr. Martinez. Dr. Miller.
Okay, so this is a disciplinary case, 12-002. And you recall there were stipulations that Dr. Martinez has since met all the stipulations. Everything's in order, so I would move that this case be closed. Be satisfied with everything the board has to do.
He has submitted all the documents, so he has been in compliance with this case. Any questions?
So these are the only ones that we're pending.
Yeah, everything's been done.
So everything is good.
Yeah, that was good too. So,
no.
Yeah.
So,
I've been promotion since just a second.
So, all in favor of closing the case of Dr. Martinez? Please indicate.
Aye.
Any opposed? None. Dr. Martinez's case is closed. The disciplinary 12-002. Thank you. We have an update. No, not gonna. This is wrong. I'll get to it. Sorry. Okay, next, let's work on a work group assignment. Because people did not volunteer, I volunteer for you. So the rules and the CE committee has indicated. Dr. Chong, because you have not participated in another work group, is there a particular work group you wanted to be involved in? Or you want to think about it? Okay. So
I volunteer.
So let me just say this with the work group assignment. When the work group meets, it means that the legal counsel and myself, especially legal counsel, as well. So as far as the time to meet, it would be, you know, as your time available and preferably in the daytime.
So
correct.
That's this complaint. What would be the purpose?
Well, if there's any I think this is the least amount of work complaint. Any complaint come in to the board, they're gonna be registered. I have a complaint against you, so I will submit it to the board and have it documented and registered, and then it will, when it's resolved, then it will be, you know, taken up.
So we're not changing the process?
No.
Is there a complaint?
So the.
That might not be a bad idea, where you name the person, profession.
Yeah.
Complaint, the log in time, the log in.
So that's something that the complaint committee can come up with.
And just to let you know, if I can say something, the environmental health, she specialist, she works for environmental health in Guam, she said that she takes oral complaints as well through the telephone.
And you can also take.
Want to say PIA, but.
How about anonymous?
No, that's not.
Cannot be anonymous.
That's wrong.
She has to talk to the caller, but they can at least do it over the phone.
But let me see.
Regarding licenses.
Because EPA often asks, you have the chance of EPA to file a complaint, say, like, it should be.
Oh, I don't know. So it's the environmental health people at PIA? Maybe we can do some, you know, as far as the complaints, the complaint processes. We can look through some sites.
Those are all great questions.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We'll look through some sites and see what is very legitimate as far as appropriate.
The reason why I'm more inclined with the written, the reason why is because, I mean, you know, Guam, everybody complained about everybody, you know, verbally. I mean, you don't want to take that all the time, you know.
Yeah, it's gonna be written. She's just gonna hear it over the phone and write down the information, and then she'll go and verify if the person called her and then present it to.
Yeah, but I don't see, if anybody wants to complain, they should put it in writing rather than you guys write it. Because that might be translated in different things. You see what I'm saying? And then also another thing too is that we're not only protecting the public, but in my position, I think we need to protect the licensees.
I understand,
yeah,
and that's not my policy. I'm just sharing it with you that's the environmental health policy.
So
they take oral complaints over the telephone, but in our office, it has to be written down. That's still special.
That could be something, you know, I'm not dismissing, but that'd be something that could that work out. The pros and cons of oral and, you know, receive it as ours, and have, you know, the staff to write down the complaint.
See, this is the kind of thing that, I think it's a great idea, you know, to have some, you know, maybe formalized procedures, standard operating procedures about, like, calendaring, you know, having a process. So, you know, really, you know, we think it really points to the real need for investigation, you know, somebody that we can hand it off to, because to me, anonymous complaints are okay, but, you know, an investigator or a lawyer is only going to be able to go so far depending on the nature of the complaint. And if you're complaining about, you know, environmental, a pigger next door, you know, it's easy to make an anonymous complaint about that because they can come out and check it. If you're complaining about what my doctor, you know, wrote me while I was in a session, we're going to need you to come forward, you know. I mean, so different, you know, things, but if we had, you know, an investigator be able to marshal this stuff. Because again, or in another sense, asking Jane and Roman and Vicki.
Janitor.
Thank you. And Marlene to also be investigators to process these things. It's too much. Okay.
You know, I just wanted to add, I don't know if you guys remember, I had brought up my neighbor's complaint in Florida. And she went to the Florida Board of Nursing, and she complained about her sister-in-law, about how she fabricated or even altered some of the documents for her CUs and her transcript. So she sent a letter out, and she got the response back from the board. And the board said, we will no longer continue to investigate this case. This case is closed. That's how it went. So, you know, even with other boards, you know, if they feel that it's legitimate, they feel that it's even worth investigating, they'll pursue it. If not, they'll just close it, and then they'll just send a goodbye letter saying that they're not going to pursue any more cases. So, you know, they can pick and choose what they want to investigate, in other words.
They can, but I think you pointed out something that's important, and that is that the complaining person needs to be notified of closure. And that's something that other boards have not done as well as we can, you know, to say, hey, look, you know, and, you know, this is part of one of the suggestions I made sometime ago, is let's just start a complaint file. You know, thanks, I received this complaint from this board, you know, so we can start to track it and, you know, a little bit of accountability back to the public on how we're handling the complaints.
What about an investigator? Would that be like hiring one person on this board, or would that be AG's office investigator?
there's all sorts of ways to do it. What my preference is to have one assigned to the HBO to be shared among the two. It's enough work for an investigator. But that's something to talk about with the senator, the legislature, Marvin, public health. What I can tell you from the AG's point of view is that we can't do what we can do. It's not a resource you can count on. Gotten the stuff.
Well, I trust you guys, Mike.
I'm not trusting anybody anymore. Okay,
so we can, I'm not sound fine now, but I'd suggest that, meet, well, other than the board meeting, meet once a month at least to start off, and I suggest that perhaps we should meet this Friday, because I know Friday's the day off. Because there's a lot of work to be done, and it's to get it. And then again, that the work group is not, for the record, is not a decision making group. It is work group, and that's any recommendation comes to full board for voting or discussion for voting. Just want to be clear. Okay, so any more questions about your, what are we going to do? No? Let's move to new business application. We have several applications. We have mostly IMFT. Vince, on Raina Calvo.
Yes, Raina Calvo is a new licensee. She's completed her 1,500 hours or more at the Superior Court. She's met all of the requirements for licensure.
Thank you.
12, 40.
No, 44.
You don't like her, nothing?
Yeah, way to do it, you're straight.
I see you, Sally.
I'll do this way.
Absolutely.
count my feet. I did that. All right, y'all done with me?
I say yes.
And you as well, nice to be seen.
Oh, Rob, I have a question. When are you going to,
I just came back.
So, you tell them today, because I keep nagging my leg, I want to go to camp.
Your wife is going to say. Every statute I have to guess that, they cover in March.
Oh, really?
But
how did you go?
Typhation.
Typhation. Oh.
Eva Air.
They have a direct flight.
Eva Air.
Oh, Eva Air direct.
Long Taipei, taxi bomb.
That's nice.
But then a lot of.
Oh, it's a lot of the doctors. When I was there, they had to dress. And then also the bomb.
Yeah, well, because you know, next year.
You like the. So, you know how they do the hangovers? Yeah. Well, I thought you get that on your mom. Okay, I see you. Thank you so much.
Get changed out then, and then you go.
I don't know when I started. But then Dave said, I said, okay, what happens when it expires? He says, we continue to serve until the governor.
Oh, no, that was old law. That was the other student. Again, you got to move my story on.
See, that's all going to happen, right? Because the bus. All the governors.
Yes, 14.
Is this board to be down to all this stuff?
You know another thing too, you know who else needs to go to other boards? That PA, how I wrote that to Dr. Gill a long time ago, that was.
Yeah, they want to.
That needs to go to Bethel. But the thing is, they haven't done.
A diet too, if you go to PA.
So, and then the other one is that nursing administrator should go to nursing board. That was brought to my attention.
We need to have a discussion about nursing, because that issue's coming up.
That should go to nursing board. Nurse administrator. It's under us.
Nursing home administrator.
Maybe. You know, before the answer doing that, I would want to kind of look around and see how jurisdictions do it.
There's only one.
There's only one here, what?
One nursing person.
There's one nursing person in St. Dominic's, I just.
Yes.
Okay, but there's somebody else that wants to start a nursing home, and he's asking around, he's going, who do I go to get my license? And we're all scratching our heads going.
Yeah, what's here?
Well, we think so. There's a statute of two, you have to look at.
I